Big Brother, mainstream media, government cover-ups. You want answers? Well, so does he. He's Alex Jones on the GCN Radio Network. And now, live from Austin, Texas, Alex Jones.
Friends, we are here fighting tyranny in a fast and furious way. You see, evil has always been in the world, but there's always been good as well. There's different forces in history. And every action we engage in, every decision we make affects that some balance of what will control the world, good or evil. The problem with good is that when you get a good generation that generally defeats certain destruction and tyranny, such incredible freedom and liberty brings so much wealth that the population becomes extremely decadent within just a few generations. I'm surprised the United States, with all of its liberty and freedom, and it hadn't been perfect, but compared to others, it's been the best we've ever seen. I'm surprised it's gone this long before falling into incredible degradation. All right, ladies and gentlemen, gold is turbo exploding today. We're going to be going over some of those numbers here on the air with talk of QE3 and the now big EU bond package plan that we told you years ago is what they would push. The very banks that have engineered the collapse have demanded bailout after bailout, which they get most of the money from, while blaming the public for the debt that they've been signed on to. And then they come out and sell the idea of a new mega bond, which in the bond agreement, the nations sign over what little sovereignty they had left. In fact, it came out earlier this year. It's just amazing. EU planners at the highest levels of the European Central Bank said, we have to get rid of nationalism entirely if we're going to set up this new government for and by the banks. And they called it banker occupation themselves. They said, we have captured Europe. You know, there were jokes about it. Goldman Sachs captures Europe. Because they need to rub it in your face to make you feel absolutely helpless and hopeless. It's part of the occupier's domination tactic throughout history. And they went on to say that they needed to get rid of Euro sports team names that have associations with French or German or Spanish or Portuguese or Dutch or Italian, any of it, and just make it about, you know, Euro teams with names like, you know, T-Rex or, you know, Cave Bear. I mean, they've actually had examples in there of, you know, the Titans, the more like U.S. sports teams that, because we're one nation, so then, you know, our teams are generally based just around mascots, except for places like Texas, because it's the, you know, the Texas teams, you know, the Cowboys, the Texans. This is something that is important. Guys, I think the gate or something's been changed on my microphone. I can definitely hear changes. I'm sure some stuff went on with the microphones yesterday. We need to turn those back to however they were. Thank you. I can just hear the difference. I can hear the gate coming in and out on me. It's over-gating things here on me. Or this microphone's going out, which I love these Neumann microphones, but I guess me banging the table and hitting them over the years, sometimes they break. So this microphone may be going out as well. This is one of the repaired ones, right, from the last time I knocked it off the table on accident? Oh, that's a brand new one? Okay, well, as long as everything sounds okay to you in there, I know audio fluctuations when I hear it in my little ears. Okay, what's coming up here on the broadcast today? Lyndon LaRouche will be joining us, who I agree with his analysis of the geopolitical lay of the land. I don't agree with all of his solutions. I always have to proviso that because much to-do has been made of Alex Jones has Lyndon LaRouche on. That means he's a communist. And then other publications say Lyndon LaRouche is extremely right-wing. And Jones is right-wing as he has him on. Lyndon LaRouche just had his 90th birthday, yesterday. Love him or hate him, you know, they had a former CIA director call him the person with the most important private intelligence network in the world. Obviously, Lyndon LaRouche knows where a lot of the bodies are buried and is an extremely interesting person. You know, and again, everybody we have here on the air, we have them here not just because I agree with everything they're saying. That's not the case in most cases. In fact, in all cases, I don't agree with what anybody says completely, including myself. Sometimes I hear rebroadcasts and I think I could have said that better, or I should have said it this way, or I don't really agree with what I said now that I've looked at it in hindsight. And I'm not like, oh, some of the neocon groups or liberal groups criticize me for having Lyndon LaRouche on because it affects me. I'm just putting it out to show how they try to mentally referee and decide who can cover what, who can do what. You know, the media got criticized, well, Drudge did, Matt Drudge, 4 or 5 years ago for reporting that Prince Harry was in Afghanistan. I mean, that's newsworthy. And the whole media, you know, reportedly knew about it but wouldn't report on it. And his story was pointing that out. And then now it's back in the news that he's back in Afghanistan to play the part of the hero after the orgy stuff came out. And, you know, there's still the criticisms of how dare anybody cover this. Just this idea that you shouldn't have this person on, or you shouldn't go on that show. I mean, they have Reverend Wright on CNN. Does that mean CNN agrees with GD America? Well, probably they actually do. But it's a nation state. Now, the point is we're going to get into gold. It is, I'm going to do an economic report later. In fact, I've got two guests coming up today. So can we just go ahead and get Ted Anderson on with a quick report on gold, say at 45 after John Harmon, see if he's actually there at the office, because Ted's been predicting this would start in early September. Not hard to predict. It normally happens, especially with talk of quantitative easing 3 coming up that'll trigger inflation big time. We're going to be having Ted come on the broadcast here a little bit later if we can get him. Gold is up to $1,736.60 as we speak. That is up, well, $36 just today. They had a flood of media saying gold isn't good to buy. It's evil. It's bad. Don't buy it. Of course, George Soros, we reported 3 weeks ago, is buying up as much as he can. All these other elitists are buying up as much as they can. And they've done everything they can with paper in the markets, leveraging and naked shorting to try to drive down gold and silver. But the laws of finance, the laws of nature when it comes to currencies, says they can suppress it for a while, like holding a beach ball down at the bottom of the deep end. But pretty soon you're going to have to come up for breath. And when you finally let go of the beach ball, it's not just going to rise slowly from 10 feet of water. It's going to shoot out of the water. And they may grab it again and try to push it to the bottom. But each time they push it down, they can't push it down as far as they did the time before. That's why gold was $260 11 years ago, and now it's $1,700 and has been as high as almost $2,000. Because if you look at the graph, over 11 years, it's going straight up. Okay, it's going up. And there's little dips, but never down as far as it was before. Could they pull some incredible scam and drive it down to $1,000? Maybe, but then following these graphs, it'll go up to $3,000 the next time, you know, if they over-devalue it. I don't have gold as an investment. I have it as an emergency backup because I don't trust this government and the system. And I don't have that much. I have enough to take care of my family for a while and some silver. But you cannot trust the money in the banks. And more big banks, big financial institutions are just taking people's money. I've got articles here all over the country today, CBS News, where they just come and take people's houses that are paid in full, and they don't even have a mortgage with Wells Fargo, and they just take it. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter if they bought that house, 25 years ago, and that it was never even sold as a derivative. They're just taking it, and the courts are going to give it to them, and nothing's going to stop them. Just like they took the veterans' death benefits, just like they've got all the police and fire and city worker funds around the country. And those city workers will squeeze you to oblivion because they're told raise more money or everything will collapse, when that's what's causing the collapse. They'll say give us a 20% carbon tax in California and everybody runs out of the state. They just don't understand it. Just like Greece and Spain and Italy, raise taxes, shuts the economy down, kills the tax base, less money comes in. Now you're in hock deeper to the bankers who loaned you fiat money to bail them out. And then now they own you. The fraud is so big, it's such a galactic-sized hoax. Now, I want to get into huge news. This is probably the biggest news of the day. We'll cover it when we come back. White House circulating draft of executive order on cybersecurity. Remember 2 months ago or a month and a half ago, the cybersecurity bill that even CNET News, that's CBS, even Declan McCullough said is basically what Vladimir Putin's doing in Russia. It's totally draconian, total spying, internet taxes, controls, tracking, nightmarish. Absolutely nightmarish. Kick you off the web, fine you, fee you, no due process, hellish. Obama said, I'll look at executive order. The Hill reports White House circulating draft of executive order on cybersecurity. So look out, Jack. Obama said, hey, don't worry. And by the way, that thing has got all sorts of draconian anti-gun stuff in it. And he says the executive order will mirror the bill. See, oh, Congress won't shut down our power plants, our coal plants? Obama just says I sign an executive order. By the way, I give all my friends waivers. I mean, hey, this is called dictatorship. And Obama is a puppet himself, a teleprompter reading puppet. Presidents will come and go, but the office has been turned into a dictatorship for all intents and purposes. When the president tells the Congress he takes orders from NATO and the UN, baby, you're not just living in a dictatorship of the executive and bureaucracy, you're living in an occupation government saying, I take my orders from Europe. That's always been who's been taking this country over. That's who we've been having wars with, is those powerful families over there. When Bush had me arrested 15 years ago, when he was governor, for asking questions at a press conference at the end of his speech, he's supposed to give a press conference. I'd heard the speech before. It was on the agenda that at this time he'd take questions. They said no questions right before his speech. So at the end of his speech, I said, Governor, isn't it Europe through the CFR taking over America, the robber barons? And he looked at the state police, and they almost ripped my shoulder out of its socket. I roll over at night, and I'm in pain today. I'm not about to have surgery on it because I dared ask them a question. They bodily hurt me. You can watch that footage online. Just because I was like, hey, you say you want to take care of Texas, what about the New World Order? And he looked over at the state police in plain clothes. One of them, I guess, was a Texas Ranger and said, deal with him. And boy, they showed me. I didn't resist. Very polite. Sure, I'll go outside. And they go, let me show you how it works. You don't ask questions in America. Now, in the next segment, I'm going to get into a White House circulating draft of executive order on cybersecurity. I mean, who needs Congress if they won't pass the bill? You just sign an executive order. I mean, why not? Why not just sign us over to Goldman Sachs publicly? But coming up in the next segment, before I get into that, I'm going to cover this. Time magazine writer jokes about dead fetuses, beauty pageant at RNC. Now, I'll be honest with you. I'm friends, well, I've known for more than 15 years, the talk show host on this show. They're pretty liberal, and my first inclination was to not even cover this, just because I know it will be seen by some, you know, as stirring up trouble. But, I mean, when something's on the radio, it's on the radio. And when it has to do with dead kids, that's when, whatever, you know, the case is, I covered it. But I was driving into work yesterday morning at about 8 a.m., came a little bit earlier, got ready here instead of at home. And I was listening to 93.7, Dudley and Bob show. And I'm listening to it. It's the sister station of 590 AM. They also have an FM that broadcasts the shows. So they have three stations. Well, they have like six or seven. It's Emmis-owned. They're nice folks. I've been on, I don't know, 6 years or so now on those stations. But the point is that... And I've been a guest on their show many times. I'm driving in, and I hear Time Magazine. In fact, I'll just cover this now. Do you guys have that queued up? I'm driving in, and I'm listening to Joel Stein of Time Magazine. And it sounds like he's like 10 years old. And the types of things they're talking about, the things they're going over, they're making fun of Republicans, and they're making fun of Christians and how they read the Bible when they protest. And things like that. And then he goes into dead fetuses and how the Republicans hold up images of dead fetuses, bloody dead fetuses. We're going to hear it here in a minute. And that he's learned to recognize the attractive ones and that they should have a beauty pageant for dead fetuses. And that was, you know, real funny. And folks were laughing about that. And the talk show hosts are... going, hey, you know, I mean, they're laughing, but then they say, hey, you're going to get us in trouble. Well, not them in trouble. Why are you saying you're going to get in trouble? Who should get in trouble? And I don't mean having their free speech attacked. I have my free speech to say it's wrong. I have my speech. See, people say free speech is not criticizing somebody's speech. No, no, no. Free speech is you got your speech, I got mine. And it's the fact that people that I know that are pro-abortion, most of them, they get off on it. They laugh. They say, you don't want those ugly black babies. You've heard those clips of abortionists. I've heard that my whole life. Speaking out against abortion in radio debates, protesting in abortion clinics. I've done that back when I was just on local TV and radio. I've gone out and protested it. And mainly just to tell the women, you know, there are charities that will pay you to have that baby and give the baby up for charity. They're not going to tell you that inside. You can be paid, I mean, a executive salary to have the kid. There's a backlog of people that want children. We have to import a babies to adopt. My family has done it. You know, you don't need to do it. Let me tell you the name of some charities. That's why you see these billboards up that say pregnant, need help, you know, don't want to have an abortion, call us. There are more people wanting to adopt than there are even abortions each year. And they don't want you knowing that. Most of those women would end up turning around and leaving, but I'm digressing. The point is that I'm driving along, and even if you want to kill babies in the womb and say they're not human, and you think that type of dehumanization is okay and isn't dangerous, because now they're saying kill babies up to age 3, the same eugenicist and bioethicist, I mean, top bioethicist journals. In fact, during the break, guys, you print me bioethics journals has killed children up to age 3. You're now calling those fetuses. If you think that's okay, that's your issue. But when you make jokes about it and you talk about, see, the babies can't speak up for themselves. Imagine if we said, let's have a beauty pageant of chopped up black people. Let's see who the prettiest chopped up bloody black person is. You would have riots. Or if you said, let's see who the prettiest chopped up gay person is. Out of a bunch of gay people that have been shot with shotguns or hacked up with machetes, let's have a beauty pageant and see who the most beautiful of the dead corpses is. There would be absolute outcry, and there should be. Okay? But the little babies, nobody's there to protect them. And I'm an extremist because as a human, the idea of women not knowing that's a child and they don't want you to have an ultrasound so you can see it, they want to chop it up because they're eugenicists. And then you make jokes about it and talk about beauty pageants. You are a piece of inhuman trash and filth, and you're going to hell. We're going to come back and play the clip. Thank you for joining us again. I'm Alex Jones, your host on this Friday, the 7th day of September 2012. I'll be back this Sunday live, 4 to 6 p.m. Central, 5 to 7 Eastern. That'll be 2 to 4 Pacific, 3 to 5 Mountain. Mountain, that's the coolest sounding time zone, isn't it? Mountain, I live in Mountain. Yes, it is Mountain out there. We're going to got some reports on gold exploding, governments, institutions, elites grabbing it up while telling you not to get it. But I want to cover this first, because there's all these world events and Israel saying they're getting ready to hit Iran, and there's, you know, giant news on the economy. We're going to get to all of it. But nobody in the mainstream media is standing up for children. It's trendy, it's cool, it's fun to make jokes and get real cheeky when you talk about abortion. And to say nobody wants these babies when it's the opposite. Let me tell you, the CPS has to kidnap healthy babies, especially from white folks. There's huge bounties on them. They can get a half mil for a raven-haired, blue-eyed girl. 200, 300 grand for a blonde-haired, blue-eyed girl or boy. I mean, there's quotas on these that's come out. They're hunting your children. A large portion of the CPS are pedophiles. That's why they have that job. They have a 50-plus percent turnover in CPS nationwide at every state. Some areas higher because good people get in who are abused as children, because there are some bad parents. But statistically, CPS is 5 times worse physically, 7 times worse sexually. Justice Department's own numbers. Look it up. That's the cover of even Time Magazine admits that. The shame of foster care. But yeah, that's not general foster care, the family down the street that's helping kids. It's the big institutions, generally, they're the worst. So, you know, let's throw them to the most dangerous people because they have, you know, examples of, you know, crackhead moms or whatever with starving kids. Well, they usually leave those kids with them, it comes out. They want those little babies. And they'll take black babies, Hispanic babies as well to for adoption. And, of course, the families don't know where they're coming from when they're getting them. There's a big bounty on those folks as well. And I've had state senators on. One of them got her head blown off after she came on. She's like, I'm coming on next week. I have the proof, the racket, the payoffs for the kids. Dead, her and her husband gunned down at their house. I mean, this is a mafia you're dealing with. You think black market art's the big business or drugs? No, it's kids. It's sex. It's just evil, ladies and gentlemen. And all of this is going on, and you've heard the abortion doctors that have been caught doing weird rituals with the dead babies. Well, yeah, who wants to sit there and do late-term abortions, chopping up, you know, 7, 8, 9-month-old babies? I mean, you got to be sick. They kill them outside the womb. It's incredible. They throw them in buckets of water. They chop them up. They sell them for medical experiments. And a lot of people don't want to hear this. They're like, I don't want to hear it. Listen, if you had an abortion and were lied to about it, it's okay. The pain will go away if you ask God to forgive you. Or if you don't even believe in God, just understand that you made a mistake and choose life. Choose to put value on humanity. The globalists want to tell us we're trash. They want to say old people are trash and children are trash and mentally retarded people are trash. Don't you understand what you do to the least of these you've done to me? That's Jesus Christ saying that. What you've done to the... And he went on. Better for you to tie a millstone around your neck than to hurt the little ones. And the little ones are also the general public who are childlike. Taking advantage of ignorant people, taking advantage of dumb people, is one of the greatest sins. And I don't need to be a Christian to know that. My soul shakes with disgust because it's so unhealthy to have that type of attitude. It's so bad. It's so wicked. I know the old saying, the big fish eat the little fish. And the globalists have bought into this pure social Darwinistic view that whatever evil they do to us, it's okay because they're in charge. That means they're the fittest. No, cancer is not the fittest. It destroys the body. It destroys the host. You are parasites. You are not alphas. Alphas lead because they're strong and they have the greatest ideas and they are admired. They lead by example and they lift up the weakest. Parasites bring down the strongest and the weakest. And you bring the weak down to a level of destruction, and then the next group becomes the weak, and you bring them down, and it implodes systems. That will not get us to Alpha Centauris. That will not get us past a Type 1 civilization that we haven't even reached yet. My goal is to win. And you know, the globalists, they think generationally, they think multi-generationally, they think long-term. They teach us to think minute-to-minute, but they don't think minute-to-minute, they think decade to century. They think out into the future. They're following a plan. We can beat them because we have the plan. And the plan has a lot of faults. It's an old plan. It's strong because they don't leave the plan, but it's weak because they don't vary the plan. You understand that? And, okay, let's break this down because I got a lot of other news I need to get to. Imagine you're driving along in your car, and you hear people that you've eaten with, you know, had drinks with over the years, gone to comedy clubs with. You don't agree with them politically, but you hear the snickering and the laughing about, you know, dead babies and bloody babies and beauty pageants for dead babies. And then you know that you'll be the square because you are repulsed by that. You are bad when you read the Daily Mail or the Associated Press. Doctors should have right to kill unwanted or disabled babies at birth as they are not a real person, claims Oxford academic. And it's actually in a prestigious journal. Now, Watson at Infowars.com, Prisma.com, he broke that a few months ago, and then others picked it up, which is, my point is, at first people thought the report was fake, even though we were linking to it by the big prestigious bioethics paper publication. But this is what Peter Singer says. He's the top guy over at Princeton, saying bioethics, saying big animal rights guy. It's not about animals' rights. It's about saying you're scum. Is that humans are trash, humans are ugly. A baby has no more value than a mackerel. That you should be able to get rid of your children if you want to. It's this idea that we're below the animals, not just on par with them. So I'm driving in my car. And this needs to become a major story because it's not just, you know, the Democrats trying to send back the fruit baskets and saying we don't want God put back in the or respect for religion put back on the Democratic platform. It's that it's just even if you don't like establishment religion, it's the frothing hate for people of faith and the disdain by these people who themselves have their own weird cultural religions of materialism or thinking they're part of an elite club when most of these so-called liberals aren't very intelligent. Chris Hedges is a smart liberal. People like Joel Stein are not. He's there to culturally scar your mind where you'll just accept anything. Because see, when you stand for something, that gets in the way of them running over you. When you've got a rudder, that means they can't just push you wherever they want. Time magazine writer jokes about dead fetuses, beauty pageant at RNC. This has now been picked up by LifeSite and some others. All they do is read scripture and have giant pictures of dead fetuses. And he went on to say, like conservative protesters, as they do, all they do is read the Bible, all they do is read scripture and have giant pictures of dead fetuses. Time responded. I've seen so many bloody fetuses that I can literally tell good-looking fetuses from ugly fetuses. You're now making fun of a dead human that never had a chance to be loved by its mommy or its daddy or see butterflies flying around, never had a chance to run around, the little feet pattering on the floor, never had a chance. You just see them as ugly. You say my species is ugly. You say humanity is ugly. I say you're ugly. Continuing, I've seen so many bloody fetuses that I can literally... I've seen so many. You're going to hear it. It's so funny. You're funny. You're a bully. Want to bully little babies in the womb when they think they're safe, chopping them up, and they're in there sucking their thumb. Make me sick. I've seen so many bloody fetuses that I can literally tell good-looking fetuses from ugly fetuses, Stein added, much to the amusement of the host. Stein then suggested that the dead fetuses should be entered into a beauty pageant. We're going to play the clip for you right here, and... I don't even hate this guy. I cringe to think of being this person. I just thank God every morning I was born to a good, decent, loving family who aren't perfect, but you know, people like this guy are a mile wide, not even an inch deep. And I'm just so thankful that I had a decent upbringing and that I came from loving people. I just cannot imagine being this type of self-propelled demon walking around the surface of the earth. I mean, look, if you want to kill babies, we're going to try to outlaw it and stop it. And if you make excuses and say it isn't human and, oh, it's your decision and, you know, there's... But you know, it's still a grim thing. I can just say you're wrong and forgive you later if you, you know, admit you were wrong. But to just... The ultimate sin is to revel in the destruction of the innocent and to know it's bad and to get off on it. So... We can use people like Joel Stein, though, to illustrate this. So get this article out to everybody. It already scrolled off the main page of Infowars.com. I'm going to ask the guys in there to red link it right now. Paul Watson article up at Infowars.com. Paul Watson and I put this article together. Here is some of the unmitigated evil. Because it's all just done like it's fun. It's fun time. Let's make jokes. Imagine making jokes about, hey, Joel, how about if you made jokes about a beauty pageant guys, can we pull up piles of dead Jews in concentration camps? Horrible, with their eyeballs eaten out by crows. You've seen those. There's even color footage of it, color film. Hey, Joel Stein, what would happen if somebody came out and said, let's have a beauty pageant of dead Jews? Oh, boy, the media get upset about that, but not little babies. See, what if we had a beauty pageant about dead soccer moms? Well, I guess they already do that. See, this is a whole culture of death being sold on us. Let's go ahead and play this clip. Here it is. And then we'll, after we play that clip, we will be able to...
All they do...
Hey, stop right there. Because for hours before the show, we got this queued up and ready. I want to cue it back up to the exact spot, and I want to play this here on air because this is important. Okay? You guys tell me when you're ready. Again, we'll just sit here until we're ready with this clip. Doesn't matter how long it takes, it's going to air. All I got to do is cue it back up where we had it. God help me. I just don't know what to do anymore. I care a lot because I understand we're going into pure dehumanization, and I just don't understand. I wanted this clip. I asked yesterday morning for people to get this, and we all day I wanted to play it. I can't even play it now. When you're ready, just tell me, guys, okay?
weirdos combined? In other words, the freakiest, craziest things you've heard.
Well, are you counting protesters or has to
sure,
be
yeah, no. The freakiest, craziest stuff has been which convention? I would think it'd be the DNC because the DNC is letting the protesters be a little closer, aren't they?
They are, but the Republican or the conservative protesters are all they do is read the Bible. They only do two things. Like the liberal protesters just rant and chant. And I don't know what they're talking about. They don't make any sense at all. But the conservative ones, all they do is read scripture,
right,
and have giant pictures of bloody fetuses.
I actually read that online.
Every 4 years, yeah. I get to see
the giant posters of dead fetuses.
I've seen so many bloody fetuses that I can literally tell good-looking fetuses from ugly fetuses. I wanted to walk around and pick a Miss Fetus.
Dude, you're getting us in trouble.
No, he's doing a great job.
That's
great.
Well, what's on tap tonight? How close will you be for the president's speech?
Well, first of all, honestly, I've been to 9 of these. Democrats logistically cannot run a convention.
No, idiotic.
Good job to the crew getting that. I asked Watson to get it yesterday, and it's in some weird podcast format that's hard to get. And then I just said, hell, put a camera on screen and videotape the damn thing so we can play it. And then it was ready to play and wouldn't. But there you go, ladies and gentlemen. It's all real funny. And God help us. I mean, we're being taught that human life's worthless, and it's all funny to these people. They're just going to go on and on and on, rubbing our face in it, and I frankly have had enough of it. I got some other really horrible news today. People are like, well, don't be so negative. Look, we're not going to turn this around if we don't start recognizing evil when we see it and calling it out. We've gotten where we're at because we're so compliant. It's a type of sick American hospitality where now we ask the government to come in and the bureaucrats and all the scum media and just run our lives and rub our faces in it and dominate us. And I think the one thing this show has given people is the courage to stand up against the thugs and the globalists. But if you don't have courage to stand up against them, you give the world to them. I'm afraid of them winning. I'm afraid of them taking over. So I fight them, not from a position of courage, from a position of survival. I don't even know what to say at this point. We've lost our spirit. We've lost our capacity to even be human because we've let a bunch of dehumanized demons take over and tell us that we should act like them and be like them. They tell us that we should eat GMO. They don't eat GMO. They tell us we should take vaccines. They don't take vaccines. It's on record that the world leaders don't take vaccines. It's come out in the news that they don't eat GMO, that they don't drink fluoride water, hydrofluorosilicic acid. Don't confuse it with calcium fluoride you actually need some of. They play on your ignorance. They feed off of it. Here's an example. Let's bring Ted Anderson up for the end of this segment and the next one. Ahead of Lyndon LaRouche and a lot more. And I've got some Barton Springs news. We live here in Austin. They're going to shut it down. Never done this before. They're going to shut it down. Just discovered that today. Found that out. But I wanted to bring Ted Anderson up because we've got all these world leaders buying gold right now in the last month. And we said, well, that means if George Soros and all these elites and big banks and universities and the Russian government, the Indian government, the Chinese government, if they're all running into gold, well, they know the QE3 is coming. Ted, tell us what's coming up after the break.
Well, I tell you what, I mean, I'm looking at George Soros's face here and listen to you talk about babies being murdered, and I'm like, I'm getting sick to my stomach. But here's this title right here is a big headline, Soros dumps stocks and buys $130 million in gold. You know, these guys know what's going on. The QE3 is coming. It's not only is it coming, crying out loud, it's happening right now in Europe. That's what all this is about. It's more like a combination of TARP and QE3 all tied together to make a hybrid. I mean, the price of gold is reflecting it, and this is happening. I mean, if you want to deny it, deny it. But I can tell you right now, we're looking at gold going up again, $35 an ounce. We're at $1,737.80 now. You know, with this kind of momentum, $2,000 gold will seem like history real fast. You know, silver right now is at $33.72. I mean, there's a lot of stuff that's going on in the gold and silver market, Alex.
We're going to be right back, ladies and gentlemen, on the other side of this quick break with Ted Anderson to go over more of this. The elites are buying gold, but they tell you not to. They don't have abortions for their kids, but they tell you to, and you run out and get it because Gloria Steinem says it's cool. I say buy gold. We'll be back. Ted, go over some of the headlines you've got there. I mean, the who's who are out there in the news buying gold. The Indian government's buying gold, but then they've got their economists telling poor Indians don't buy gold because the globalists obviously want to hoard gold themselves while using paper to try to suppress the price. Why is that, Ted?
Well, because they want to continue to keep us, the common man, in paper. That's the game. You realize that the Federal Reserve System, the banks in Japan, the banks in, you know, all the central banks, they're in the business of creating paper and using and having the people use that paper as money. If the people no longer accept the paper, their game is over. They no longer can profit from it. They no longer can control the masses. I mean, they really need to keep us in paper. That's why they want that. They'll push and they'll try to keep people out of gold. They'll do everything they can to manipulate that. At the same time, you can read the headlines. What are the central banks doing with their own resources? They're putting it into gold. So guess what? They're trying to convince you to stay away from gold and silver. They're telling you why. Like, for instance, I'm looking at a big old picture of George Soros. Looks like he's standing on top of the world. And it says, why buying gold after Paulson and Soros is foolish. Well, Soros is buying the gold because he knows what's going on. He's an insider. He can see it. There's no question about it. We're going to see the value of paper money go down because of the fact that there's so many problems.
Exactly. Here's the bottom line. This is obviously a gold pitch because, again, it's very simple. We are self-financed. We promote what we use, what we believe in. I buy my gold and silver from Midas Resources. In bullion, gold and silver, you can't beat the prices. They are very competitive on numismatics as well. But bottom line, Ted, then also helps get the word out. So you vote with your dollars, you get a great deal on gold and silver from somebody who supports liberty. But the issue here is Ted Anderson has been buying gold when it was at 1670 and things, and now he's going to be able to sell you that gold until it runs out, even though it's at, let me hit refresh, 1730-something last time I looked. Yes, it's 1736 right now with the system trying to drive it down. But it's the talk of QE3, the global devaluation, Moody's saying Europe's going to basically go under, the new ECB mega bond plan that ends the sovereignty of the nations by bankruptcy. This is all there. That's why I believe, that's why I am in silver and gold. That's why I was completely confident when gold was dropped down some to not sell any of it. Because my gut tells me it's only going up. Now, you know, are Easter Bunny real? Maybe. The point is that I don't get it, you know, as an investment. But it could go down someday. Who knows? Anything's possible. Again, leprechauns could be real. But everything points towards devaluation. So you can call Midas Resources, the parent company of the GCN Radio Network, or I should say sister company. It's not only the parent, though it helped fund and create it. They're two tandems. So to be technical, it's not a subsidiary. It's a sister. But the point is, I get caught in minutia, folks. You know I do that. The issue here is Ted's got a big list of gold and silver that is bullion. A lot of it actually collectible at bullion prices. It's the Alex Jones radio specials. You've got to ask about those when you call to get even more competitive rates than what they have at MidasResources.com, which already has very competitive special deals for the internet. So 800-686-2237, 800-686-2237. Give Ted Anderson and his great brokers there a call. Tell them you want the Alex Jones specials. They can also tell you about some of the other specials they've got. But we got about 30 seconds left, Ted. 800-686-237. What are some of the best deals you've got right now on gold and silver?
Well, if I have 30 seconds, the $63 for the two silver dollars, the book and the DVD, that is a steal because silver just went up another $2 an ounce. You're getting it for less than cost.
How long until you have to go up on prices with gold up over 50 bucks right now in the last few days? How long until you got to go up on prices?
I only have a little bit of supply left and people are calling, so you can pretty much guess that it's going to end today.
All right. Ladies and gentlemen, in this short segment, I'm going to cover an issue near and dear to my heart, but similar things to this are happening around the country. Government likes to dominate and take things over. A national treasure is in Austin, Texas. It's giant, 68-degree, mineral-rich springs that blast out of the rock. Native Americans, it was a sacred place. Spanish explorers camped out there. For 500 years of known history, Western history, it's been used by Europeans. It's Barton Springs, and I've been so busy over the years, I haven't had a chance to use it a lot, but I've started making myself go and swim a few days a week. And this morning, it was the strangest thing. I was just thinking, man, I can't believe the government that's dedicated to ruining everything good hadn't put TSA here or something, or hasn't shut this down. And all of a sudden, I was finishing my mile swim. I had to hurry back and get back to the office. And all of a sudden, I see six, seven construction-type bureaucrats and city people come in, and they're looking down in the water. I mean, it looks like the Caribbean in the morning there. We're talking like 20 feet deep in areas. Ocean eels come up the Colorado just to live there. There's like four-foot eels in there. And I get up, and I go over, and I listen to them, because nobody dare talk to people wearing hard hats and stuff. There's no construction going on, but they're all wearing vests, nanny state hard hats. They've got the Austin Aquatics head person there. And they're pointing down the water. And because alumni from UT, we have all the articles here, Aaron, because alumni from UT, it turns out 2 years ago, didn't like the fact there was little cracks here and there in the 1920s, 30s, and 40s cement on the sides, which is totally structurally sound. They were admitting that. Some little rebar down the bottom where they paved an area of it back in the 40s. So just some little rebar, instead of just patching it or something. They are going to drain it. They wanted to for a year. Then it was spending 9 months, then 6 months. They're going to now, and I go over and I listen to them, and they're going, yeah, we're shutting it down October 1st, and they have the plans all pulled out, and I'm listening. That's called spying, but I mean, I'm just right there hearing it all. And I go up and talk to the manager, and they go, no, no, there'll be a riot. No, no, no. Well, they won't tell us what they're planning. And I go, no, they're right down there now. Go down there. They're right down there saying they're going to shut it down until next summer, maybe longer. And they're going to tear everything out and drain it down to 1 foot. The eels will die, everything. Forget the stupid salamanders. There's plenty of those. It's all made up. And there's the bass are all eating them. There's like 2 foot bass in there. They're going to drain it, annihilate it. All because the UT Richie Riches don't want to see some old concrete that looks awesome. It looks awesome. I mean, my little feet pattered on that when I was a baby. Aaron, we only got a few minutes left. We'll have you back on about this. But I had you go double check it this morning. You found it in the Daily Texan. They're going to shut it down for 9 months. Tell us about it.
Well, they have one plan for 9 months. They say specifically it's going to be closed for sure in October and all winter long, completely shut down. They're going to let just in October the deep end be open. But they've tacked on hundreds of thousands, millions of dollars to deal with the environmental issue of the salamanders. And who's really getting all that money is probably a bigger question. But it's a big infrastructure boondoggle, and people probably don't know from around the country that water is great year-round. People swim in there all year round.
Well, yeah, because when it's cold outside, all of a sudden the cold water is warm.
Yeah.
It's bizarre, and you know what? Lyndon LaRouche is coming up, but at the next little five-minute segment, at the start of the next hour, we'll come back in and you could actually go over it all. The point is, they use ignorance, because when I walked over and I said, really, you're closing in October, and he goes, well, I didn't say that officially. And then I found out, other than this article from 2 years ago, they've never wanted anybody to know. So the people running the pool don't know because they don't want the slaves finding out and saying, and they go, well, it's a safety issue. And I go, what, is it going to collapse? No. No, but there's some rebar down there. I go, why don't you just patch that? I mean, that's from them in the 40s trying to pave the bottom of it. We don't want the bottom of it paved. Yeah. They're idiots.
Yeah, it's great there, but they've been planning this project, I guess, somewhat secretly for 3 years.
Well, that's because 3 years ago, people said, we don't want it.
Yeah.
And so now they're going to sneak attack again.
That's true.
These governments do not serve us. Why don't you all just go out to your Formula One we're paying for? You know, taxpayers pay for it. And get out of Austin, Lee Leffingwell, and all you scum. And all you UT alumni Richie Riches. Go swim in your swimming pools. Ladies and gentlemen, for the balance of the hour, we're going to be joined by Lyndon LaRouche here in a moment. If you don't know who he is, look into who he really is, not who the media says he is. Very interesting person with an amazing historical perspective. And I hear he's got a birthday. Has he already had it or is it tomorrow? We're going to find out from the man himself. I guess I could go to Wikipedia and find out, but so much of what they say is wrong. We're going to be having Lyndon LaRouche on here in just a moment from his offices to break down what's happening in the world. And here's just an example. UN armed intervention may be necessary in Syria. That is an official UN press release. Well, there already is armed intervention. The West has been sending in al-Qaeda and others, and that is now admitted. What we told you 8 months ago when the latest thing started, we told you a year and a half ago the Libya thing was started as a pretext. And now Iran is sending elite troops to aid al-Assad's regime in Syria. That's the London Telegraph, and that's official out of Iran as well. So this is a full-blown proxy war, ladies and gentlemen. Barack hints the U.S. would join Israel in Iran strike. We share the challenge through our timetables are not the same, the defense minister says. Pre-Rosh Hashanah political event, Defense Minister Ehud Barak appeared to hint last night that he believed the United States would join Israel in a strike on Iran to prevent the Islamic Republic from obtaining nuclear weapons. So it's all moving towards that. Israel says differences remain between U.S. and Iran. That's Fox News. Canada closes embassy in Iran. That's a big sign. Intelligence Committee chair describes explosive confrontation between Netanyahu and American ambassador, complete with yelling and screaming at each other. Venezuela grabs U.S. ships saying it has arms. That's Forbes. The point is, things are going into hyper gear. Obama's talking about signing a executive order right now to go ahead and have the Pentagon take over the internet. Even CBS News says it's draconian, anti-free speech. I mean, when they're saying that, you know you're in trouble. All of this is happening, and in the backdrop, Europe has been downgraded by Moody's to negative outlook. They're coming out with a super bond that'll just put people more into debt to the oligarch banks. All of this is happening, and that's why we've got Lyndon LaRouche joining us. Because he was called by, you can look this up. I remember hearing this a couple of years ago. I went and looked it up. It was in the Washington Post. It was true. The CIA director back in the 80s called him, you know, the best intelligence, private intelligence operation in the world. National Security Council members said similar things. He used to land for weekly meetings himself and by helicopter at the CIA command center. You know, Ronald Reagan read his information and people got jealous, George Herbert Walker, and had him set up and put in prison. Just amazing the type of stuff that they do. And it doesn't mean that I agree with all of Lyndon LaRouche's solutions, but his historical perspective is dead on. And the more I learn in my own research, the more I learn how right he is, which has become a big media event, that Jones is a LaRouchean. Now, what I am is a seeker of truth. That's what I'm seeking out. And that's why he's here with us. And, sir, I hear that you are just about 90 years old. If you count 9 months in your mother's womb, I guess over 90. But I tell you, you don't look a day above 75. What's your secret to longevity?
I don't know. Maybe there's some virtue there somewhere or some reward for something I had done or not done. I just enjoy doing what I do. I feel committed to what I'm doing.
What is your birthday? Is it today or tomorrow?
Tomorrow is tomorrow.
Wow, so you'll be 90 years old on September 8th.
Yep.
Well, happy birthday.
Well, thank you.
No one can say that you've sat around on your hind end for 90 years.
No. A lot of other places, but not that.
Wow. Let's get into world events first. Then I do want to speak a little bit about Lyndon LaRouche today and also open the phones up at the bottom of the hour for people that have questions or comments for you. But, I mean, I just read over just a snapshot of news today. I see the world lining up like we saw before the first two world wars. Am I wrong in intellectually, historically, but also in my gut, feeling the serious tremors in the force?
I think there are only two major sources of threat. One is the British monarchy, and the other is the British monarchy's puppet, which is Obama. The situation is that as the Joint Chiefs of Staff of the United States have shown, they understand that any war that breaks out now, such as in the Middle East or elsewhere, will be a thermonuclear war. There may be other minor things and conflicts which are going on, but any time the force comes in and someone says we're going to start the attack, it's going to be a full global attack, and it's going to be thermonuclear. And the question is, will anybody survive eventually, not merely out of the war? Because if you get the Soviet or Russian and Chinese capabilities, which are very significant, and against the United States and Britain and something from France, which is the other side, and these forces are going to go against each other on a thermonuclear basis from the get-go. And that means that our submarines, our major submarines, are going to launch in their time. It's going to be a full launch, probably one or two rounds. Maybe within an hour and a half, it's all over. And the world looks pretty dead. So we're at a point where the idea of simple war, or war breaking out, or incidents leading to war, is not going to happen. What's happened is Russia and China have made a very firm commitment not to start a war, but to defend against it. Most people in the United States want no part of this. The only person but really behind it is the president, Obama. And Obama's with the Queen, but most of the people in Britain are not for this nonsense either. So we're on the verge of the worst kind of warfare one could imagine, which would break out very suddenly, with very little warning on any part. Certain services, such as the U.S. services, would understand and know that this is going on immediately.
Well, let me stop you there, sir, because what you're saying is obviously right on target, but people may not understand. The last two chairmen of the Joint Chiefs, the last three heads of CENTCOM, as you know, people can look this up, journalists can look this up, have refused to attack Iran, saying it would bring in China and Russia. Now they've sent the fleets over to menace China, and they think that that's going to allow this attack. But now even Dempsey, who's been known as not as smart as his predecessors, has been convinced and came out, as you know, last week and said, hey, I mean, the exact quote was a headline was, do not blame us when Israel strikes and don't think we're supporting it. So that type, I mean, to have chairman of the Joint Chiefs saying that shows that the military establishment, who love wars, I mean, you know, that's their, I mean, that's what they do. I mean, they love to be commanded off to war generally, are saying, do not do this. What, I mean, how significant is that? That signifies a mutiny within the saner sectors of the power structure.
I'm not sure the word mutiny is the right term. The point is, because nothing that the Joint Chiefs and others are doing in that, to that effect, is a violation of anything on their part.
Sure, sure. I mean, that's the wrong term. It's a sanity call. What would you call it then?
The point is, if you've got to throw this president out of office, even though he's just been nominated, I don't think it's going to stick. And he's not in a winning position right now.
But what does it mean inside the government, where you have so many connections, to have the chairman of the Joint Chiefs come out and say something countervailing what the president and certain sectors of Israel are pushing?
Yeah, but the Joint Chiefs are operating within their powers of government. And the president doesn't dare challenge that directly. Because the president is not a popular president.
Am I right to say that it's seismic, though? I mean, how big of a deal is it to have the chairman of the Joint Chiefs come out, say that, and it gets almost no press?
You're talking about, if you're a member of the Joint Chiefs, and you're a patriot as I am, you're not going to play games and guessing games or anything with this policy. We know that any major war that breaks out on this planet will be a thermonuclear war. There are no minor wars possible. You cannot have a continuation of the war with the Middle East at all. Any such war will lead to thermonuclear war immediately. And that means that within about an hour and a half, most of the world is dead. And anyone who is competent, like the Joint Chiefs or other people of the same interest, have Russians or Chinese, all the same thing. This war must not occur. And if somebody tries to start it, we should get them out of the way quick. Because if we let this war happen, we're in the age of thermonuclear warfare, and nobody can win thermonuclear warfare. The human race might go extinct within the aftermath of such an attack. So no sane person, and I wouldn't include this president as sane, no sane person wants to start such a war. There are other means we're going to have to use to deal with conflict. Many of the means are not conflict at all. They're just arguments about how we're going to settle things. But we've come to a time where we have to learn the truth. You cannot have war among major nations today. No sane head of government would launch it. But I think there are some people who are not so sane, including our current president. But don't assume that with all the bula-bula that he's going to win this election. Right now, he's running as a loser, not because the other guys are smart, but because he is so bad. And he's losing anything resembling friends and supporters at a rapid rate.
Again, you have a lot of connections inside the Pentagon, CIA, you name it. I want to get their take on where this is going, other October surprises that this regime could pull, and how we do avert kicking off a wider war in the Middle East. The big proxy war is already on. We don't have a nuclear war, so I can still go out and hear people like Jimmy Vaughn play. Down with Big Brother. All right, going back now to Lyndon LaRouche, who's with us for the balance of the hour. Very honored to have him. The toll-free number to join us if you've got any questions or comments for him coming up in the next segment. This is a short segment, long segment coming up. Our 800-259-9231. First-time callers for Lyndon LaRouche, 800-259-9231. Lyndon, again, with all of your sources, I remember you were on a couple of years ago and you said it was building up to this. Now we're here. The power structure that thinks it can have this war, that's trying to overthrow Russia with proxy groups and political groups, the George Soros types, what do they think they're doing? Because then I have neocon groups come out and say, I'm bad and anti-American because I don't want to have war and I'm not supporting Obama. So it's elements of the conservative groups and, you know, the so-called Obama people. I mean, I'm bad, you're bad because we don't want to have a giant war that even the top military in the news said will probably lead to a war with Russia or China. I mean, how are we bad for not wanting World War III?
Well, the point is, I think that the powers that be are really do not intend to have a thermonuclear war. They intend to have a limited kind of conflict, hope that they can break up resistance and take over and then kill people. Now, the best way to kill people is being done in the United States by those interests who have shut off the food supply. Those who were insisting, like this president, on cutting out food consumption in an area where we are running short of the food necessary to meet people, and he's trying to turn it into gasoline or something of that sort. It's the attempt to use bluff, threats, even terrible threats, exemplary cruelties, these kinds of things, trying to break the will of nation after nation, the way we unconstitutionally got into a war in Libya, which was a violation of our Constitution. And it's that wear and tear process, working on people's nerves and trying to derive them, intimidate them, and so forth. And the problem we have here is you see it in the election campaign. Now, Obama is not winning the election right now. Now, I don't know what's going to happen in the future. That's a different matter. But the game is the bluff, intimidation, bluff, threats. Look, the murders in the Middle East, the daily, weekly murders this president is doing without any constitutional authorization for it. So what you're seeing here is you're seeing a few people who are using the method of bluff to intimidate. If we ever got our act together in the United States, for example, we would have him out of there right away. And that can be done very quickly. We have the evidence to throw him out of office. Well, the problem, we have a weakness on the Republican side on this thing, as well as the problems on the Democratic side.
Well, as you point out, Congressman Jones from North Carolina has introduced the legislation to begin the impeachment. Obama says that NATO and other groups command our military and that Congress should just sit down and shut up.
Well, I think the truth of the matter is that there are some of us in the United States who are influential. As you know, there are a limited number of people who are really influential in the sense that they can push things in a direction which is, say, positive or the other way. And it's a limited number of people. The rest of them tend to follow pressures put upon them. And I think we're at the point that the really responsible layers in the United States, apart from the very much frightened and quiet one, remember, the poverty of our people, the suffering of our people is beyond anything. This is worse than the last, Great Depression. And our people are suffering this under this president in particular. I mean, the deliberate action by him in cutting down the food supply in order to make more gasoline, in order to starve farmers and others to death, that's the kind of thing you're dealing with right now. And if we get our act together as a nation, together with other nations who you may not like, but will cooperate with us on this, that cooperation can settle this matter. The problem is we haven't gotten that organized well enough together right now.
Amazing. Lyndon LaRouche is our guest, and you can also visit their website, LaRouchePack.com, or also LaRouchePub.com. Lyndon LaRouche will be with us on the other side to take phone calls. But before we do that, I want to ask him what else is front and center on his radar. I've got some articles from their site I want to go over. And I want to look at the economy in more detail, the state of the economy, what's happening with the euro, where he sees the dollar going straight ahead. Well, he turns 90 tomorrow, Lyndon LaRouche. And he is with us on the line right now. Your phone calls are coming up. Lyndon, finishing up with all of your contacts in the Defense Department, in the CIA, everywhere else. Again, even the Washington Post admits you have amazing contacts. And you were here over a year ago saying that the military didn't want to do this. And so much of what you've talked about has now come out in mainstream media. So tell us what else is going on from your contacts that we're not aware of, that we don't know about, that's happening inside of the power structure.
Well, just take the things that don't get discussed one way or the other, at least not in a significant way. Let's take the case of Curiosity. We launched a successful flight of this instrument to Mars. And that may seem just like something very spectacular. It got a lot of support from people, a lot of sympathy. It was done in defiance of Obama. And that's important. Now, the issue here is this. The problems we're talking about on politics are not so much the real issues for the long term. The great danger that we're facing is the danger from rocks in space. Now, this issue has been around for a long time. Edward Teller, the famous Edward Teller, now deceased, was a key sponsor of this effort to deal with this problem. It is an actual serious threat to mankind. Now, we have over periods of time, we have these giant rocks hitting different parts of the planet and taking out areas such as the equivalent of entire city areas, metropolitan cities, things like that. But once in a while, you get in the history of mankind, not in terms of living history of mankind, but of the territory, you get one big rock hits the Earth, and everybody on Earth dies, or everything on Earth tends to die. It may come back later. So we're now in a point where the key issue before us in terms of defense of nations is the defense of Earth from these rocks. And the increase of the danger of that source is notable. So therefore, we've got to do something about it. And what happened was, by putting this thing over the president's strongest objections, to put this thing on Mars, on Curiosity, on Mars, we set into place an absolutely indispensable mechanism by which, at the speed of light, which is the communication between us and Mars, we can determine things and make decisions and to plan actions which will enable us now to realize what Edward Teller tried to deal with while he was still alive, the danger of rocks from the area of Jupiter down into so forth.
Well, that's right. Well, when they saw Shoemaker-Levy crash into one of the gas giants and they did calculations, they know now that every few thousand years we get hit by big rocks, every 100 or 1,000 or so we get hit by these big mega rocks, every million or so ones that kill most life on the planet. And it just shows that why does the current ruling elite, because we've had corrupt elites before, but they wanted to build things, they wanted to advance things, they wanted to, I mean, even old colonialism, depending on the variant, did some good. Overall, it was bad. But now I see things like the new Obama 2012 film with Dinesh D'Souza coming out. And he's there, you know, saying Obama is a anti-colonialist. That's why he wants to destroy the West. But really, he's one of these British monarchy monopoly globalists that is actually trying to destroy the old hearts of empire. They're in a type of Malthusian de-evolution program against the old nation states. How would you quantify that?
I would quantify that by the British monarchy quantification. Reduce the human population, presently estimated in the range of 7 billion persons, to 1 billion persons in a short order. And that's the British policy. That's the policy of Obama. Well, he hasn't put it in exactly those terms, but that's what it is. What has he done? We don't have production of food anymore. We are destroying food supplies as they're being produced by turning them into, you know, chemical fuels. So we are actually in a process of a small group of people, really. It's not a big crowd. It's a small group of people. But our people have been so crushed. Most people in the United States are crushed. Their existence is being crushed. And, you know, since the past three generations, or the past three administrations, the rate of destruction of our economy is horrible. So the problem, the issue, real issue is to get back to a real economy, which means we have to get rid of this hyperinflation, and that can be done by one law. We can get rid of the whole hyperinflation.
Bring back Glass-Steagall?
Yep. It'll do
it. Let me ask you this question, because I know you're a historian in this area. I mean, this is a Venetian black nobility balkanization form of welfare developed between the city-states in what is Italy today. We know that it's exported to England. That then becomes the model of empire. But why, get us into the minds of these people. Why do they want to not have a space program? Why do they want to make people poor? Why do they love, I mean, why are they so evil?
Well, take the case of the Roman Empire. Roman Empire died, and all these empire systems have died. They've died out of their own self-destruction beforehand. Byzantium, the same kind of thing. The old Venetian system, again, the same thing. The Dark Ages were the old system. Then you had a revival of the same kind of system, which came up with the Anglo-Dutch version, which was called the New Venetian Party. The New Venetian Party was then established the British monarchy and established it as an empire. And so, therefore, you have a history of this tradition of this kind of system, of the, what we call the oligarchical system, comes up where a few people are tried by various means to control the planet or large parts of it, and do a general destructive thing. The problem has been that despite our constitution and despite our intention and the intention of some other countries to this effect, we have not been able to secure an actual system of government which conforms to what our intention was in creating the United States. Even the United States was unable during much of its history to avoid being crushed and gobbled up by oligarchical influences. And that's the same thing now. You have a very small minority of the influential part of the populations of various nations who are now raising hell against the human species. And this old thing is there, and we have somehow lost the guts to get rid of it. Because what you see with the Joint Chiefs of Staff of the United States, and you see with similar institutions in Europe and other parts of the world, that we do have the implicit ability to mobilize the kind of reforms which could be readily applied now to give us a system of global nation states, which would be, they might not all agree with each other, but we have a way of living together as nation states.
Briefly, before we go to calls, sir, can we get your take on the current state of the economy and what's happening in Europe and where you see all of that going?
We're on the verge of an actual disintegration of the world economy, a chain reaction kind of breakdown. If this policy continues, if Obama were to continue as president, I can assure you that you would not have civilization on this planet. So and the Republicans aren't doing anything good, but Obama is something with his foreign influences, which is the greatest threat to the existence of the United States and other nations that I know of on this planet today.
What did you make of his statement telling entrepreneurs and scientists and inventors that you didn't build that? I mean, that was a calculated statement. What is the point of a statement like that?
Well, the man lies. There's no truth in him. He's a pathological case. As a matter of fact, as I've described him, if you back in history, he's a guy somebody picked up as a result of a wise guy dirty trick, as an echo of the Emperor Nero. And if you read the history, the detailed history of the Emperor Nero, and you look at the mentality of this president, you find the two things concur. They coincide. But somebody and some people got the bright idea of taking this character and by means which I wouldn't call exactly legal, got him picked as a president and stuck him in office. And you see what he's done since being in office. He's done everything indirectly as imitations, to some degree Adolf Hitler, in the sense that similar kinds of things were done, and were done by the Emperor Nero and a few other creeps in between there.
Well, yeah, trying to shut down most our coal power plants, trying to pass carbon taxes, trying to end free speech, arresting journalists who talk to whistleblowers, charging whistleblowers with the Espionage Act. I had Chris Hedges, the renowned Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist on, who's a very respected, quote, liberal, and he said Obama is much worse than Bush. And we could say, well, Bush, Obama are puppets. But whatever oligarchy team is behind him are raving lunatics, because there is a madness of power. We tend to look at elites and say they know what they're doing. There's a method to the madness. But you talk about Nero or Caligula. Those are good examples. I mean, it really is. They're so disconnected. It's like what's coming out at the Justice Department. These women are resigning now, so that lends credence, and a lot of other suits are getting filed. The bizarre sexual escapades, the dressed up in dominatrix outfits, calling men into their offices, the doing things on air I can't even mention. This is a group of lunatics.
A fair term.
So what do you expect them to do to try to hold on to power? Because you're right. Big Democrats like Hillary aren't going. Rahm Emanuel, left early from the convention this week. Was it Newsweek or was it Time came out and said, "Hit the road, Obama." I mean, it does look like a lot of the power structure is moving away from Obama. Why is that?
Well, essentially, they know that. But the part of it is the way the control works. The control works through a few very powerful, also financially powerful people in various parts of the world who are able to lure other people into going along with this kind of stuff. You see, many people, for example, we don't have any industries left in the United States today. They were taken away. Taken away in the past dozen years, especially. The people feel powerless. Many people are going to die of starvation, actually, in the United States, and for other reasons. The situation of our people is hopeless, and yet it's very difficult to mobilize the people to defend themselves.
Well, yeah, we've got 47 million people roughly on food stamps. You've got just all these other economic numbers that show we're really in a depression for 4 years. You've got crime exploding, but the mainstream media tries to put a cover on it and say, oh, we left the recession 4 years ago. It's almost a Marie Antoinette, let them eat cake. While the Obama administration does everything it can with Economics 101 to hurt poor people while posing as their savior. Imagine if we didn't have the people on the welfare cards, the digital food stamp cards, having 47 million people on the street at soup lines, what that would look like every day.
Well, the problem is that our government has failed us. Our political parties have failed us. The political parties go along to get along. That's their slogan. And this has been, they've been a charge for that for a long time. This slogan of the Senate, the slogan of the Congress, go along to get along. And the rule that generally rules our congressional system, our representative system, is that piece of corruption called go along to get along, which is the motto of the Congress. And as long as we allow the Congress to go along to get along, and thus refusing to challenge their colleagues in the Congress to cut this crap out, then we get this kind of government.
Yeah, I know what's happening historically, and I want your brief take on this, and we're going to go to call, sir. So many times you mentioned Nero and others. When they have all this power, the people in control at the very top start almost flirting with disaster, almost tempting it in their indolence, in their spoiled rottenness. It's like a moth to flame, and they play with destruction. They flirt with it and then bring it.
That's the case of history. You take what we know of human history. We know that this kind of phenomenon is the source of all corruptions. It's something which becomes a kind of a mass movement of self-corruption. And those things have happened. Whole nations and even empires have disintegrated under that kind of corruption. We have not yet succeeded, except in a few exceptional terms, especially in trying to do that with the North American development of our system. But even our system then became corrupted in the same way.
Look, when Time magazine writer Joel Stein makes fun of aborted babies, and I covered it before you got on, and says we should have a beauty pageant of dead babies, and this is Time magazine, it's reached a level of just insane Romans running around doing the types of things that Nero did at parties. And it just shows that these are lunatics. Let's go to phone calls. Joe in South Carolina, you're on the air with Lyndon LaRouche. Go ahead.
Yes, thank you very much. Mr. LaRouche, 2 points. One, you talk about trying to mobilize the people to fix things here, get rid of people like Obama. When we have something like the GOP that clearly doesn't want to fix the problem, obviously, because if they really wanted to get rid of Obama, they'd put someone like Ron Paul or the like of that as the candidate, because you pull all the Republicans, you pull a lot of independents, you pull a lot of other people that support that kind of character and would get rid of someone like Obama and start fixing the problem. So we don't even have a political party that A, has the clout, and then B, the second point is that our electoral system is rigged to a certain extent. I mean, our computer...
Yeah, but I mean, there needs to be a question here because we don't have a lot of time. The bottom line is he's saying the power structure itself is beginning to ignore the corrupt elements at the top, and that's the real revolution, is the velvet restoration of intellectually not complying, not going along, and speaking out against the system. I mean, is that what you're getting at, Lyndon?
Well, no, specifically what happens is when many people start to suffer and there's not enough to go along, then some people decide that, well, somebody have to survive and we have to survive. Unfortunately, other people will have to go. And when that policy comes in and that practice comes in, that's what you've got right now. You've got that attitude within many parts of the public. You've got people in desperate conditions, and nothing is being done. And the president who's doing this to them, the worst president we had in our history, this president, is actually the engineer who's being given the support to carry out just exactly those policies.
Amazing. All right, we're going to come back, talk to Brad, listening on XM 166, talk to Scott, Joseph, Anthony. With quick questions, folks, you can, for Lyndon LaRouche, I mean, kind of a speech about how we're in trouble, the political system's corrupt. Yeah, we've been talking about that for 40 minutes, 45 minutes. I mean, we know that. I'm not saying the caller's a bad caller. It's just that, yes, exactly. We have an insane ruling elite. New TSA documents are out. Checkpoints on the highways with body scanners. Get ready. That just broke at InfoWars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. Lyndon LaRouche is our guest here. Let's go to Brad in Virginia, listening on XM Channel 166. Welcome, sir. You're on the air.
Thank you, sir. Love your show. First-time caller. Mr. LaRouche, you're a great patriot. Thank you for all that you're doing to bring these this evil to the public's attention. I want to first state that it seems like a lot of effort can be wasted trying to identify the source of the evil when we all know that the source of the evil is unseen. My question to you is, given the fact, how do we, based upon your wisdom, organize on the local level to be effective and maintain effectiveness without trying to steer it to a Dem Republican-type standoff?
The point is, don't worry about it. What we have to do is you always start with a small force to organize something. And if you can't do it, you can't do it. And then the world goes into a bad condition as a result. But the point is, what I find out that I concentrate only on things that I think are worth defending, or more than worth defending, are urgent to be defended. And that's the only way, you know, and to do that, you've got to get some knowledge. You have to know what you're talking about. You've got to know what you're talking about, not only in terms of analysis, you've got to know what you're talking about in terms of what will work.
Don't wait for orders from headquarters. Just go to the sound of the guns. And, you know, I have been somebody who says, oh, lesser of two evils, I'm not going to vote for anybody. But the fact that you know, that even people like Lyndon LaRouche are saying, you know, don't vote for Obama when he's nonpartisan, shows you that that group is so criminal and so insane, they've got to go. And we're not saying Romney's good either, but getting, you know, at least something new in will give people a breather. I mean, is that what you're getting at, Lyndon, or am I wrong?
In that direction. If we're fighting for the right thing and stick to it and don't try to be opportunistic, but because people have seen so many lies and the lies to which they've been subjected by people who they thought represented them have made them very angry.
So what do you do in the election then? I mean, just like kind of stand, I mean...
I don't believe that party systems are that important. You know, George Washington didn't want a party system, but some other people in the United States decided they wanted party systems.
No, I agree with you. I don't like the party system. It turns into gangs. So what are you saying? We can just take over a party, create a new party, get rid of the parties? What do you do?
No, the problem is this. Is when people get so partisan that they think they're playing a football or a baseball game and don't think about the effect for the nation. They decide they're going to have a party and they're going to win. I think that's nonsense. I think the question is to try to educate people and bring them to an understanding of what the real problems are.
No, I agree. We'll never fix the party system if people don't understand we're run by foreign banking oligarchs. Mr. LaRouche, have you noticed suddenly in financial publications and CNBC, they're bragging that we've been conquered by a banking oligarchy, but saying the bankers know best? What is this flaunting in our face?
Well, they're actually whistling Dixie, so to speak, because they don't have anywhere. Look at the whole situation in Europe. Look at the situation in the United States. Look at all these institutions that claim to manage international finance. They're not controlling anything. Any day now, any moment, the entire Europe, Western, the Central European system can disintegrate. Now, our people in Europe and I, together, don't want the disintegration of Europe. But there are people who say, we're going to force you to do as we want, or we're going to destroy you. And people are sometimes intimidated and fall prey to this sort of thing. But the only thing you can do, you've got to fight for the truth. If you can't fight for the truth, you're going to lose anyway. So I think the point is being independent. But also I think the mistake is the kind of partisanships, which is like a football game. Or
tell you what, do five more minutes with us. I want you to be able to finish up on that and take a few calls if you can. Five more minutes with Lyndon LaRouche. He'll turn 90 tomorrow. I'm Alex Jones, your host, if you just joined us. Got a bunch of breaking news coming up in the next segment. And then the makers of a new film that's being developed, very impressive what I've seen so far, Gray State, are going to be joining us. So that is coming up as well. But we are talking right now to Lyndon LaRouche. Lyndon, you were getting into the collapse of Europe. I mean, this is a design collapse, and they're saying now they're going to use the nations in debt to shine them fully over to private banks that will now run the EU itself. And you're right. They say they're in control. They're in control of the of the arson they've engaged in, but now it's out of control, and it really just does seem like a disconnect. I mean, take John Corzine and others that are, you know, making 40-to-1 bets with people's money. There is an insanity to these people. They were bold enough to get into power because they are crazy and arrogant and daring. We good people need to just dare back. I mean, I think that's really it, is that we can't let their intimidation get to us. I mean, is that the essence of what you're saying?
I would say, I would look at it the other way, from the positive side. What has to be done to cure the problem? Not trying to, we know what the problem is. And just talking about the problem is not going to cure it. But you need only clarity about what the nature of the problem is. But like the European system, if Europe does not, Europe could do one thing. Glass-Steagall is now becoming very popular in Europe, sometimes even more popular than in the United States. But Glass-Steagall is the only thing that will save either Europe or the United States right now. Without Glass-Steagall, the U.S. economy, the European economy, worse, are dead. So it's time for Glass-Steagall, and that won't be enough. But there are other measures which can, a couple of other measures which would work. We can revive this economy if we want to. Europe could also, with cooperation with the United States in this kind of approach, could also make it. China could make it. Russia could make it. Other nations could make it. We can make it if we have the will and judgment to do what should be done. When they're trying to play games, either my game or nothing, that kind of thing is what's going to kill us.
And they want an economy where they implode things because they can organize the controlled collapse and consolidate it. This is a neo-feudalistic, piratical wrecker system, and we have to recognize that and remove the people that are engineering society in this direction.
Well, when people depend upon money per se as their idea of economy, they're going to do this. This economy of the United States, as originally created, we got into this money business, but the foundation of our Constitution was not a money system. It was the creation of federal credit used as a monetary form of credit in order to give credit for financing, that is, people who had useful ideas would get credit for developing those ideas. The object was not to get money for money's sake. The object was to use and create a system of credit, which was monetized in order to provide the funds needed to create the employment, which would be productive for the nation.
Sure, if they were giving 0% credit to the productive small businesses and not turning off our power plants and not doing everything they can to shut us down, we'd be booming. That's why the Federal Reserve says, oh, we're overheating, we're going to do this and that. They don't want us being wealthy. That's what feudalism is making us poor, controlling us through economic degradation.
I could tell you one thing on this that's probably relevant for this purpose. I could solve this problem. I know all the solutions. I'm an economist. I've been the best economist as a forecaster in the United States history in recent years. I know how to do these things. They can be done. The other people beside me know how they can be done. All we have to do is decide we're going to do it. And we can get this country back and we can build other countries too.
Wow, we'll have to have you back very soon. Have a great birthday tomorrow. Lyndon LaRouche, thank you for being gracious with your time.
Thank you.
And folks, you'll see the new film you guys have. It's right there behind you, Unsurvivable, there at your website. Thank you so much for joining us. All right. We'll be right back, ladies and gentlemen, on the other side of this quick break. I'm Alex Jones with PrisonPlanet.tv. Okay, for the next 40 minutes or so, we've got some amazing filmmakers on with us because I've seen the trailer for the film they're making called Gray State. Very impressive. They also interviewed me at Bilderberg for separate documentaries that they're producing. And just first-rate work from what I've seen. Very exciting because a film like this, properly developed and deployed, is the type of thing that could really wake up a nation. That's happened with books and films before. You never know which film, which book is going to do it, or if it's a consortium of books and films together that causes the tipping point. And we're almost there. So we're going to be talking to those gentlemen here in just a moment. Then after they leave us, we'll have about 15 minutes of other very, very important breaking news here. More new documents show that TSA intends to deploy body scanners at rail, bus, and ferry terminals. We all knew that was coming. And more Fourier documents have come out now. The abuse, basically rape that's going on with objects, so that their hands they're using on people, and how they say it will be everywhere. Highway checkpoints, rail, bus, ferry terminals, everywhere. The accursed federal they're not even police. It'd be bad enough to have police doing it. Just very, very frightening. It says millimeter wave, microwave technology, and that they'd be rolling it out. So that's been the plan since 2008. A very important report by Steve Watson at Infowars.com. This has been the plan for a very long time. An update, Canada not only has closed its embassy in Iran today, they've now expelled Iranian diplomats, and other countries are doing that. This is the closest we've ever gotten to this war kicking off. They've sent fleets off to menace the Chinese. People are like, what, you saying the commies are good? No, but we got globalist bankers running us that are trying to start wars, folks. You don't want a war with the communist Chinese or the Russians. Meanwhile, the globalists are playing both sides, handing over our infrastructure, handing over our jobs, tax incentives to ship our jobs to China, you know, to ship General Motors. I mean, it's a multifaceted attack program. And it's insane is what it is. And it's just the people running our planet are out of control and do not have our best interest at heart. There is no doubt of that. Other TSA news here. TSA kicks woman off flight for bad attitude. She got it on video. They come up to her after she's gone through the stupid slave training, Fallujah training checkpoint, prisoner training checkpoint. She buys a bottle of water inside of a shop. They walk over. They said, we want that. And she went ahead and just drank it in front of them. Because in the old days, they'd say, drink that to show it's not a weapon. And again, it's about you're guilty, you're going to do what I say. It's nothing but I'm going to peck at you till you do what I want. Amazing video up at prisonplanet.com and infowars.com. And Watson's article is a great headline, TSA kicks woman off flight for bad attitude. But that it's really not that. TSA kicks woman out of airport for drinking water. And the TSA minion, no, they're not an agent, they're not an officer, says, no, I did it because we're going to punish you for not letting us stick a tester in your bottled water. And, of course, when our story went viral this week, they had Dallas Morning News called a hoax that there was a liquid bomb on a flight from Philadelphia to Dallas. I mean, this is just absolutely criminal organization because this is the big power grab. They don't care if 40 billion years lost in tourism. They don't care if it turns everybody against the government because they're going ahead with it. They're going to be everywhere, including your house. They're not stopping. And now police, federal judges are ruling, can stick their hands down your pants without warrants or probable cause or do whatever they want if they're trained by the TSA. You heard me right. You take some goon, that's how tyrants work. They create a goon force, a brown shirt force, and then say to the German military and police, see, you won't do this, but our gangs will. Then finally they go, you know what, military? You will do what they've done. And once the military and police start doing it, they go, now you get to kill them. Go ahead and kill them now. You never liked these goons. You can kill them now, or you can arrest them now. And that's what Stalin did. Lenin did it. Mao did it. Hitler did it. There's an exact playbook that's run, okay? And we're watching it all be played out here. The difference is our forebears were put time bombs in against tyranny. The Second Amendment, free speech, all these things. Time bombs. And so it isn't going to go the way it went in other countries here. It's already not going that way. They're way behind. So that's some of the news. The cybersecurity legislation, he wants executive order now that he can't get draconian censorship. I mean, this is big, folks. Rule by executive decree. That's just some of the news and information we have now. Going to our guest here, joining us via video Skype, if you're watching on prisonplanet.tv, David Crowley. And Danny August Mason, and the website is graystatemovie.com. And I was at Bilderberg, you know, protesting 8, 9, 10 hours a day, bullhorning, shaking hands, and then going back into, you know, radio and TV until the wee hours of the morning. So I was pretty exhausted, but the last day before I left, they wanted an interview. And I didn't even know what it was for. I was like, Gray State documentary? Okay, sure. They asked some good questions, and I kind of stumbled off. And then I saw the trailer a month ago or so, and I've been meaning to get them on ever since. And we'll be playing some of the trailer without audio because it doesn't translate well on radio. But for people watching on the internet, We'll be playing some of the video in the background while they speak. But, I mean, it looks like a trailer that would be produced by HBO or something. In fact, it looks like a trailer that would be produced for a $20 million budget movie. Wouldn't say B, but, you know, wouldn't say, wouldn't say Jerry Bruckheimer. But it looks like HBO quality. I mean, it's right up there. And imagine what they could do with funding. And I'm not associated with the movie. I'm not, you know, I don't have stock in it or anything. I just like to see things produced and made. I helped, you know, start Luke Radowski off and We Are Change, so many other groups. That's how you defeat people is by creating all these other organizations. That's how you defeat the globalists. That's how you defeat tyrants, is creating so many movements and groups or helping get them rolling to where you can't be stopped. You reach critical mass. And I really hope these guys get this film made. Briefly, people want to know about you individually from graystatemovie.com. So in a minute each, David Crowley first, then Danny Mason. Tell us about yourselves and the impressive film you're working on, and you're also trying to crowdsource fund now. Charlie Manson's records are finally going to get produced with hundreds of thousands of dollars thanks to crowdsourcing. So if that scumbag can get his stuff produced off the crowdsourcing, I hope you can. So let's give it a shot here today. Tell us about yourselves and then about the film.
Hey, Alex, good to talk to you again. I'm David Crowley. I'm the writer and director of Gray State. And I'm a veteran, I'm a husband, I'm a father. And the interesting thing about this material, once you delve into it, is that everyone has to act within their own capacity to express this information. So Gray State has been my effort to kind of draw the human narrative out of all this terrifying information that we see all around us. And I think that's been my responsibility as a filmmaker to kind of craft a human story out of this. And I think what I want to definitely tell your listeners is that every time you look at some of these things happening, like, why isn't anyone showing this in a film? I mean, that is what I'm doing. That is what Gray State is. Gray State is the Alex Jones film, essentially. But as my role as a soldier having to serve in Iraq and Afghanistan, I definitely can see the consequences of these kind of trends playing out and not being corrected. So Gray State definitely shows that.
Well said. Yeah, my name's Danny. Alex, first off, thanks for having us on the show. I'm an actor, co-creator, and help consult the story for Gray State. I've actually been lecturing on the topic about dealing with FEMA, also Federal Reserve, United Nations, for about 5 years now across the country. And I guess collaborated with David back in 2010. Yep. About the information on it. And we both were on the same page about it, and it just kind of spawned from there. And ever since then, it's just been a hell of a ride. So it's definitely, instead of just being just an action film, it's definitely more of a narrative film, character-driven piece. And that's what we're sticking to our guns with on it.
I think that's an important distinction to make, is that it's not a documentary. Where a documentary will pander to a certain crowd who already subscribes to those beliefs, this is a narrative film. It's a literal movie you're going to go to the theater and see. So just imagine the possibilities there. I mean, mainstream media, in effect, has usurped our traditional heritage of storytelling as a means of passing on our culture. As an anti-culture, all we have are movies. So the mainstream media, in that usurpation of that, they've been able to dominate what we see and hear and what we pass on to our children. So imagine if we get a film like Gray State showing, in a 1984 sort of format, certain consequences of a failure to embrace liberty.
Yeah, I tried to get Rick Linkletter to make a 1984 but future dystopic, and he did make Scanner Darkly, which is excellent, but I wanted one that was contemporary to a military takeover. I mean I just told him about it and talked about it, but this looks about like the quality of something that he would put out. I mean, it looks really, really good. How did you guys, I mean, how much money did this trailer cost? Because I mean, I can see it with the crowds, the actors, they're all doing a really good job. I mean, this looks like HBO quality here. How did you get this done?
Well, when Danny came to us and he's like, hey guys, check out FEMA camps, check out these things. And we're like, okay. And then it's like, oh, wow, this is important and we should probably pay attention. So of course we go about making a film because that's what we do. But my partner Mitch and I run a production company called Hothead Productions. And we do photography, videography, and filmmaking, of course. And so basically, Gray State, while you say it looks good, that is essentially cheated just out of pocket from Mitch and I's production company, and it's doing what we do best, making films in an independent fashion. So we went through the entire production process for every scene for a trailer. I mean, we had to do location permits and casting and arranging all these resources. But yeah, it was funded basically on a budget of about
$6,000. Yeah, I would like to help you guys, you know, get this done, but also because I've actually been around Hollywood and what goes on there. You've got to be careful, because 99% of the time, some big fish will come along claiming they're going to help you, and all they'll do is pay you a little money, take control of it, and then never produce it. So if I was you, you're going the right way crowdsourcing. I would not take any big money or big investors. They will kill your film. David Crowley, Danny Mason, GrayStateMovie.com. Let's get more into the plot of the film and how much funding you need to get it done properly to then put it in theaters. You've seen what Obama 2016 has done. I mean, it's reached tens of millions of people, and it's made, I don't know, $20 million, whatever it is now. And the cinematography is great and everything, but the budget of that looks like maybe $1 million. The point is that this is where you're actually able to reach people. And a fictional account of near future paralleling reality, I think, is a great way to go. But tell people where they can go to learn more about it and where they can go to crowdsource it. Explain how you're trying to fund this.
All right. All details about the film are available at graystatemovie.com. But our crowdfunding is at indiegogo.com/graystatemovie.
And you've got links at graystatemovie.com to that.
Yep.
And you've raised $13,000. You're trying to raise $50,000.
Well, one important thing that we should say is that $50,000 is simply just to get us off the ground. This movie cannot be made via crowdsourcing. I mean, if we want to do it right, if we want to lend it the scale that it needs, I mean, Mitch and I can cheat it this way. And we spent $6,000 on the trailer. You say it looks like $1 million. If we get $1 million, it'll look like $6 million and, you know, so on. But crowdfunding is not how we're going to fund it, but it is how we're going to get it seen by the right people.
Well, they've had tens of millions raised with crowdfunding. I saw an idea just a few weeks ago to have these little watches, just little cheap watches with with different faces. They wanted to raise a couple hundred thousand. They raised like $12 million and had to cut off the money coming into them. So I wouldn't sell yourself short going
hopefully
on this.
You're right, Alex.
Yeah, hopefully.
That would require a massive grassroots campaign similar to what Ron Paul has done.
Yeah.
We need to get out there. And we've had the campaign going for 30 days. And so far, we've only gotten 13,000 out of 50,000. And that's
yeah, well, Ron Paul would have kept going if Jesse Benton hadn't started calling his main supporters extremist, right, as we've seen from Peter Schiff's email telling them not to, you know. And I mean, now those of us that know what's going on, we're the bad guys. Ron Paul's still a great guy, but the Republican establishment is literally taking everything over. But I don't want to get off into that. Break down the plot of the film for people, or an overview, so they know what we're trying to get out to people.
Well, an important distinction to make is that the trailer is sort of a Hollywood style trailer showing a lot of action and stuff. And that's not really what the film is about. The film takes place in the context of a future societal breakdown, which does parallel reality trends that we see every day. The story itself will, of course, follow a character who goes through a character arc, and it tells a very human story exploring human truths. That's an important distinction to make. This isn't a snuff film. It's not fear propaganda. It's not fear mongering. It is a human film. So it follows a narrative.
It's really a love story.
It can be described. It's almost a monster movie. It's a love story. It's all of these things. It's very, very layered. It doesn't chronicle the collapse, but it follows characters and what the decisions they have to make in the event of a societal economic collapse, police state, martial law.
Yeah.
We got a couple tweets out at twitter.com/realalexjones. Go retweet those, folks. Systematic takeover of liberty, bringing the new world order. Gray State Movie director and lead actor live now. So I guess that's the tweet. I was telling him to send out a tweet just pointing out, go check out the site and help get the film made. I think that's probably what we need to tweet, but and we've also got folks tuning in there at The Real Alex Jones on Twitter. But I mean, obviously, it shows economic collapse, takeover, people being rounded up. All those real preparations are being made. So regardless, you know, I mean, just the trailer you've made helps give people kind of an image of where this is going to go. If we just decide that anything in a uniform's God, well, the corrupt system will take that as a signal to move forward.
Absolutely. And going into the trailer, we realized we had to be extremely visual stimulating on the images. So you see a lot of haunting images of soldiers on the streets, raids into the house, black bagging, haunting images. And that's only the best way we could do it for actually selling the product, for the getting the film funded on it.
But so, we are trying to be true to reality itself. So it's not necessarily a polarized debate saying soldiers are bad or soldiers are good. We have characters embedded in the film that follow very real decision-making problems. I mean, the scenarios include just a National Guard soldier. Am I going to follow my orders? And this goes back on like what the conversations we've had with Stuart Rhodes and the Oath Keepers. Are you going to follow orders and round up people and put the gun to the back of the head of the American people? Or are you going to exercise your own moral capabilities and make the right choice? The soldiers will go through, the soldiers and police in the film go through that realistically. It's not a polarized thing where we're going to say police and military are bad.
And also too, and we show a couple characters in that who are actually as civilians are regular people and about their decisions. If they're going to go along with a takeover or if they're going to go against it and actually...
The scarier part is what the civilians are going to do.
Exactly. And by the way, the takeover is ongoing. If we resist too much politically, they'll stage terror attacks to launch the hot war against us. We'll be right back. We'll talk about the guillotines in the film.
We're on the...
Crowley, writer, producer, editor, VFX artist, composer, very talented folks, and Danny Mason, who is an actor and director, you name it, in theater and film, University of Kansas. Won't go over their whole bio, but greatstatemovie.com. And I like to have people on like this sometime who have a passion and a dream. Because in just the process of trying to make their film, they're putting out mini documentaries, they're putting out trailers, they're already reaching hundreds of thousands and then hopefully millions of people. And we need to help people who are trying to get the word out. We need to help folks that are trying to fight tyranny. Because so many people, they either want some big, giant, elaborate master plan that it's going to perfectly, in a chain reaction, like one of those toys where you put the marble in one end and it goes through all the different ladders and loops and elevators and comes out perfectly, or they don't want to do it. And so much of it is just saying, I'm standing up for the truth. We know what classical tyranny and oppression is. It's happening here. And the people that have hijacked our country, they're admitting that. I mean, they're admitting that we're an occupied nation by foreign banks. They're admitting they're getting rid of the Bill of Rights and Constitution. They're putting RFID and satellite trackers on children nationwide. They know fluoride gives you brain cancer and bone cancer and dumbs you down. I mean, Harvard admits it. These are really evil people. And they don't move against us all because they don't really have the power. They have to convince us to go along with them. So graystatemovie.com, and we are going to tweet out right now. It's going up at Infowars.com, the trailer itself, and we will tweet that out to you if you're following us at Real Alex Jones. Aaron Dykes is coming in with some breaking news after our guests leave us, and I've got some other breaking news. We got about 6-7 minutes left with them, and I want to get them back on in the near future, maybe premiere some of their many documentaries on the nightly news to break down what they're doing. But, gentlemen, give us a sneak peek of kind of the script. You're asking for funding and support here. People are going to want to know. We get the general idea, but you say not a horror movie. Well, tyranny is horror. So I get it's a love story. You know, you love your wife, you love your family, so you better be ready to fight the evil. But, I mean, you got people in white hoods with guillotines as kind of Illuminati executioners and lining people up and shooting them. That's actually the plan in the re-education centers. The Army admits now they do have re-education camps. Since we talked in at Bilderberg, that's now been confirmed that they have the re-education camps. So just chilling things happening here. Tell us a little bit about the plot and the man at the guillotine.
Well, that scene does not necessarily happen in the actual feature film. What will happen in the film is the reason we call it Gray State, or one of the reasons, is that it's a division of reality. So we have people who are living in the Alex Jones world who know what's going on, and the people who simply don't. And the description being that it's requiring more and more work to support that illusion. And what will happen when it's finally contested? It's no longer just a luxury to believe in that false world where you just go to your job and everything.
So it's almost like the Matrix. People are so propagandized, they don't know that on the other side of town, they got guillotines chopping people's heads off.
And they won't believe it, Alex. The thing is, we know that they will not believe it. And that's kind of the striated response we've gotten on the trailer. It's either A, this is awesome and it's almost true, or B, this is a bad, this is not real, and that's why I'm not going to watch the film. And what it does is it shows us how close to reality we're actually getting, because it's that emotional knee-jerk response.
Well, yeah, people think that if they deny it, it suddenly makes it not real.
Exactly.
Yeah, because their reality is a form of religion for them. And the more you encroach on that, it's more you question their morals and ethics and even spiritualism. And it becomes a very, sensitive ground. And the whole entire, the reason why we put the guillotine in it was more of the symbolism behind it, going back to a very dark, medieval time, almost like cultish. So,
and we know that that's something that they would do because it's symbolic, it's brutal, and it's efficient. And actually something that happens in the actual Gray State thing is that they're going to start sending you something in the mail saying you have to go operate the guillotine when they round up suspected dissenters and put them in line.
Well, I was about to stop you. You guys have done amazing research. Tell us briefly about your awakenings and what brought you to this point, because I sent out my reporters 2 days ago to do Man on the Street, and they were down at a Starbucks downtown, and they're dressed nice, Linda West and John Bound and others were out there. And all of a sudden, they're out in front of Starbucks, and a guy comes out in a three-piece suit, and they say, "Hi, sir, we'd like to interview you, get your take on just the state of things in America, your view on things." And that's all they said to him, and he goes, "Yeah, I got somebody for you." And he goes in, comes up with a camera, starts taking photos of him, and the police pull up, and then just, checked him out. But, I mean, a woman in a business suit now with the Infowars.com microphone saying, "Hi, we're getting your take on the state of things, just the state of America." That guy guaranteed was InfraGuard, and they've literally recruited almost everyone in an executive position, even what you'd say is low-level, dentists, doctors, or tried to recruit them. Almost every doctor my dad knows, medical or dental, has had a Homeland Security visit. I mean, in America, and they're like, "Well, what do you want me to watch for?" "We want you just to watch what people are saying about the government, what they're doing, what you spy on your patients." My dad's like, "No way." He thought it was just him. It was others. I mean, this is already there. And again, this is the government. It's like, "Well, we're doing it for your safety." They're the ones that got the underwear bomber on the plane. They're the ones that ran Amarillo-Lockey. They're the ones putting the fluoride in their water. It's like, wow, they really are consciously engaged in a takeover. And they've got all these weird little minders that feel like secret agents. Because I've seen their training videos, their training manuals. I'm sent by people on the inside. It's come out about InfraGuard. And they even give the higher-level InfraGuards firearms and tell them they're secretly deputized federally, that they'll be given. This even came out in mainstream news. Several big articles a few years ago even had the writer on about it, the headline guys, if you look it up, was something like InfraGuard being given license to kill. And in the documents they got, it was in, again, major news, it was like 5 years ago, they were being prepared that during an emergency, they would have to kill some of their employees. Like, the FBI may order you to start killing people. So, and like the average executive is like on a power trip with a pistol in their drawer and an FBI card, literally shaking with pleasure in this delusion of television that they're like a secret agent now and it's really cool. No, they're going to be throwing you against the public when the globalists are involved in a takeover. I don't think people understand what you just said is what they're already training them for. Go ahead. So, I mean, I want you to comment on that briefly, but then also tell me your view of that.
Well, I think the essence is pretty much what they're doing, not go too much on a soapbox, is prepping society to accept oppression as a form of security, and with that, and giving up your liberties and rights on it. And most importantly is giving up this idea of free will and choice and what you actually do with that choice.
And for whatever reason, if you're American, this simply does not apply to you, as if we're somehow immune to the rhythms of history. And Alex, I want to thank you, because we owe a lot of the this information coming out because of you and your organization.
Yes.
A lot of people like to say that, well, you guys are just Alex Jones acolytes, and that makes you bad, and that makes me not want to listen to you. Well, we have nothing to gain from you being right about this, Alex. If you're right, we're not going to make the film.
Yeah, we're screwed.
Yeah, but if you're wrong, I mean, why? If we're wrong, we can go on and make films and have a
successful career. Yeah, but listen, the cowards always attack those that are telling it like it is. I mean, it's official they're training the military for gun confiscation. It's official that they have the FEMA camps now. And do, you know, do we get told, hey, great job, you were right. Here's the Army document, re-education camps. When good people in the Army leak it, the Army admits it's real. No, we're even more wrong when we're right. You understand that?
Yeah, that's absolutely true. Yeah, that's been the response on YouTube. 97% positive, 3%. You guys are crazy. Get out the tinfoil hats. I'm not going to watch your film.
But you notice they'll still 3% dominate the comments because they're paid. And a lot of those are admitted sock puppets. Those aren't even people.
That could very well be true. But the scary thing about gray state is that you're going to have those people who speak out, but they represent a silent majority. The 97% who don't win revolutions, those are the scary ones, because the second you challenge their entitlements, like in a scenario the gray state suggests, they're going to revolt. So if revolutions are won by the 3%, they're going to be turned on by the 97%, and that is the real gray state. There is the people who are so mind controlled, they don't listen to facts on a reasonable basis. And they deny whatever you say just because.
And it's crazy because I've been researching this material since even when I was really, really young. And I think just from that, always having the questions about situations with government and also with foreign affairs and foreign policies at the same time, to never accept the truth as it is, but always to go on your own. Well, in terms of research and whatever the truth is going to lie in the individual. And it's just our jobs as artists and our responsibility to present the truth. And whatever that truth is dependent on the interpretation of the individual.
And that's not something you've seen from art lately. Like in the 60s, what they did is art represented reality and they represented the zeitgeist of that time. We haven't seen that.
It was a fantastic movement. It just got shunned. And that's what we're attempting to do.
You haven't seen that recently. A gray state, I'm not saying it's unique. I'm not saying it's perfect, going back to what you said before. But it's one exercise in retaking our mainstream
resistance
media.
Is victory. I mean, if we just resist, it's like a muscle building. We're going to get stronger and better as we go. And so stop waiting. I mean, that's why I love what you're doing. You're just going at it, and you're also going at something big, but have already created amazing, thought-provoking information in the process. So it is, you know, the old saying of it's not the destination, it's the journey. That's the trip. And I hope people right now go to your website and donate to it, $5, $10, $20, because if you won't exercise your First Amendment today, you'll never exercise the second. And the first is more powerful if you use it up front than the second. It's a cop-out to just get a bunch of guns and sit around on them all day and say, I'm going to kill somebody if they come and try to put me in jail. Why don't you instead try to wake up the minions of the system before you have to think about the point of, oh, my God, they're going to take me to a FEMA camp. Okay, it's time to get the guns out because you're not going to let them take you to a re-education camp. And we're getting to that point. And then
talks about, Alex, is the second the guns come out, 80% casualties, 80% fatalities. We do not want it to come to that point by any means. And
by the way, you talked about Iraq. Well, I mean, in a moment, just briefly talking about Iraq and Afghanistan, where you were. I mean, they admit all that's a laboratory for here. I've read MIT Magazine saying what we did in Fallujah with the cameras, the trackers, the face scanners, we're going to do that here. And now police are on the highway at checkpoints with face scanners. I mean, it's here. This is here. Go ahead.
Oh, also,
we know that's true.
Yeah, with drones and with everything.
Yeah, they're trying to impose martial law, the same model that they do overseas. Yeah. And we know that, Alex. We know that. What's next? That's why we're making a film to show the people who otherwise would not be recipients of this message.
I mean, we were just on a brief note. We were shooting this way before any Occupy Wall Street came out. Anything from like the NDAA ever came out. And when these events started taking place and people started looking at the images and finally saw the trailer, they just started looking at us like, what's next? We don't know. We were just thinking ahead of what would be the worst case scenario and like the scariest thing to come across visually. So
just because we have that luxury as filmmakers to show something, but also not have to prove it. We can explore these possible.
I mean, here's the deal. The system is openly preparing for war against us. And
the film is true. The film is essentially, it could be described as a documentary.
Now I interrupted you a moment ago, so we're almost out of time. What was the point you were trying to make?
Oh, I was just going to say that going back to the nature of resistance is victory. That is a statement that the gray state does a very good job of describing. Even though you may be killed resisting, the act of resistance on a metaphysical level has value. So we can reassign. I mean, it's not about Ron Paul. We know that now. Yeah. It's not about retaking the country and, you know, persisting in this paradigm. It's about finding out who you are as a person, as a human being, and resisting coercion.
in this realm and also in the other realms too. And I'll just only hint at that.
It's a very layered script.
It is.
It's metaphysical.
Well, no, the fight is at its core spiritual, and you'd have to be in deep denial and delusion spiritually now to not know that the shadows are getting long here. Gentlemen, amazing. Again, the website, both the websites for people to go find out what's going on. We're also just posted the full trailer at Infowars.com for people to pass around. But give people the websites one more time.
GrayStateMovie.com and Facebook.com/GrayStateMovie, Indiegogo.com/GrayStateMovie. This is a film you're going to want to see because it's everything that Alex says put on screen.
Yes.
It's going to be so brutal because we don't pull any punches. This is not our game to pander to the lowest common denominator. We're going to make it as brutal as we possibly can because that is the reality we're facing.
And it's up to the people to help us out.
Right, because so no studio is going to touch this.
No, not
so
at all.
So we need you guys' support.
And we want to keep it independent and grassroots.
Sure. So. David Crowley, Danny and Mason, we'll talk to you both again soon.
Absolutely. Thanks for having us on, Alex.
Thanks, Alex.
Very exciting. A lot of neat stuff over on their website as well. Aaron, we're going to go to break and come back because we tried to start this earlier and never got to it. And it's a big deal, not just for people that live outside Austin, but it's a big deal for people all over the country because it's the same thing everywhere. They are trying to take Barton Springs, but this is an example of compartmentalization. I want you to get started here because you went and just double-checked my research. I said, this is what they told me. Go check it out. The managers didn't even know this at Barton Springs, the big giant spring-fed pool that everybody loves here in Austin, one of the best in the country or the world. It's world-class. There they are. I'm watching 6-7 bureaucrats with charts. I go over. They got hard hats on some of them, and I go, what are you doing? We're going to shut it down October 1st. We're going to drain it down to 1 foot deep, and that's the end of it. And it's going to be closed until next summer, probably. And I'm sitting there looking at them, and I go, okay. And then one of them looked at me smart mouth and said, and there's mermaids. And these are like, people with city badges on and all this stuff. I'm like, okay, because I was the only one who dare go up and talk to him. I'm like one of these weirdos that talks to people. Like, hey, I see you all creeping around. What are you doing? And so, again, there's nothing wrong structurally. They even admitted that. It said the UT community wants it to look nicer. They don't want the 20s and 30s and 40s concrete. It's awesome. And so there's some little rebar, they said, in one spot. So they're going to tear it all out, pretty much drain it, and shut it down. Well, the reporter says 11 months. You actually dug up in the Daily Texan the whole fact here about this. But it just shows how I then go up and talk to the managers, and they knew nothing about it, Aaron.
Right.
And they said, really, really? Because no one's going to put up with that. They won't tell us. They won't even tell the people that work there. One of the biggest pools in the country. They won't even tell them. This just shows how there's this culture of never talking to the slaves. Go ahead.
And they have some of the information posted on the Barton Springs public process website, but it's extremely limited. It's one-line sentences about how it's going to be closed during October, partially. The deep end will be open, but it's going to be definitely closed all winter. It's supposed to be opened again in time for March for the swimmers to come back in spring, but they have a budget to extend that construction process pretty much indefinitely.
Well, they're always going to take over. When they're done, they'll have it just for UT alumni. They'll have a stupid Bevo sign because the UT's involved.
But you're right. It's a big project for UT graduate students to prove they can do engineering, and it's their chance at a big practical project.
Well, it's like I went to the other city fed pool, and the cops had taken it over yesterday. I mean, it's just this country's just gone. I mean, it's just anything good, they'll wreck it. And they're now announcing they will have TSA on the streets of Austin. And I guarantee you they're going to be there wanting to grab your genitals before you go in. I mean, this country, this is their takeover. This is their time of evil. And it's not even needed. It's just another big ripoff boondoggle. We need to look into the construction companies getting the money. I want UT out of there. Go have your Formula One, okay? I already have to pay for that, you trash. We'll talk about it when we get back. All right, folks, final segment in this hour. We've got footage down there with the heads of Barton Springs not even knowing about what's admitted shutdown, which could be a year long. They don't. The head managers, we've got their cards. Rob Dew's been down there today. They don't even know. This is an example of people we were just talking about with Graystate. They don't even know what's going on. And it is a bypass for Barton Springs, a bypass from Barton Creek, a culvert that goes by it that isn't even affecting the stream. And they could literally have a regular construction crew in like 2 weeks or less redo that. I mean, I had construction guys out of my house that built a big giant wall. I guarantee you they could put a new pipe in there in a couple weeks. I mean, it's insane. So it's this giant thing with UT involved. And I'm not bashing UT. My whole family went there. It's just that it's this big, big economic takeover arm. And I'm just so sick of it, Aaron, that no one knows. Like, I go listen to them and hear them go, well, it could be 11 months, could be a year. And I go, oh, excuse me, what's going on here? Oh, we're shutting down October 1st. And I'm like, oh, why do you want to know? We're looking for the mermaids? And it's like, you know, the head planning commission of the city. I'm reading there. I'm just like, I'm sorry, I'm a slave. And then I go up and tell the manager, hey, they're saying they're going to shut down. They won't tell us. Because people got mad 2 years ago when they tried. That's why. So they're just going to shut the thing down. No one knows. It's a conspiracy theory, Aaron. You've got it all, though, from their own planning commission.
I do. And the thing is, we talked about this earlier. People may not know this pool is swimmable year-round. It's perfect temperature water all year-round, even in the winter. But they're going to shut it down, close off public access. And whether that culvert's necessary or not, it doesn't look that necessary to me. But it has something to do with supposedly rerouting rain.
And also the safety of one tree's roots.
Well, that's a separate matter. That's a separate boondoggle. But just this thing about closing down the pool for the culvert has been going on for 2 or 3 years because of the environmental concerns. They had to get multiple environmental boards to approve of their plans and make sure.
Oh, they're talking about not even letting humans in it because our sunscreen may hurt the salamanders.
But this
project, which the bass are gobbling.
The project could have been done for a couple $100,000, even if it's necessary. Instead, it's a $2 or $3 million+ project.
No, because it's always about somebody's brother getting our money.
Yeah.
And again, this stuff's going on everywhere. He ran into the SOS people. They're like, look at all the land we've taken around Austin. And Rob Dew goes, and you've now built on it. She goes, well, yes. Yeah, the former city council that did all this, took the land, they all own it now. Literally, they own the banks that finance it. They build on it. These people are incredible. They will shut that place down. They will. They are just anything good. They will ruin it. I'm so sick of government. They're the filth of the earth. They couldn't tie their shoelaces.
Well, you mentioned the tree. This is at Barton Springs, the beautiful pool with very limited infrastructure. It's just a concreted in natural spring, flows right through. But they want to save the trees and move the entrance because too many people are walking on the roots of the trees, they say. No plans.
And the trees are completely fine. Again, humans touching trees is evil. It's a power grab. Anything good, they're going to rip you off.
But they have to have $100,000 for this tree.
Oh, no, they got to charge $5 to park when the park's been paid for forever, and they charge you to get in.
Yeah.
All right, Aaron, well, I'm going to cover it more on the nightly news tonight because it just shows the sickness. But again, no one even knows. We were just on the phone with the director, and they don't even know about it. They're like, really? People aren't going to like that? Read! It's public!
I got a contact number. Nobody would answer the phone. I called 3 times.
We just sent Dew down there. People are like, hey, Alex, why are you covering this when World War III is about to happen? It's a microcosm of the mental illness of these people. Thank you, Aaron Dykes.
Thanks, Alex.
Big nightly news tonight, 7 o'clock. I'm going to be on there. A lot more. Darren McBrain's got some big breaking news. Don't forget your purchase of books and videos at InfoWarsStore.com finances what we're doing. And finally, the book is now a film, Genetic Roulette, The Gamble of Our Lives, Jeffrey M. Smith with all the top scientists, allergies, autism, infertility, birth defects, cancer. It's all GMO, folks. InfoWarsStore.com, just out today, discounted with free citizen rule book. Modafinil, the incredible detoxing, just energizes me. We've got it discounted. Pure brown seaweed extract available at InfoWarsStore.com. And at InfoWarsHealth.com, the Pollen Burst Plus with Alex Jones on the cover. The amazing EFAs. We're now carrying Interfood. InfoWarsHealth.com, ladies and gentlemen, or drink fluoride.
Thank you for listening to GCN. Visit GCNLive.com today.